every believer, every person who's a committed Christian, should normally give 10% of the income they receive to the local church they attend. It's not a law. It was a law in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, it's a principle. There are obviously some exceptions to this. There are some, for example, wives with non-Christian husbands and others. And there are others that actually should be giving an awful lot more than 10% because God has blessed them with so much. But that's the starting place.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
Well, we finished the series looking at Thessalonians, and if you missed the ending of that, you'll find it on the website. And over these few weeks between now and Christmas, I'm looking at a number of separate issues, so a different issue each time. And this morning, we're going to be looking, as you can see from the screen, at the subject of money. Now, I don't often speak about money. In fact, the last time I talked about money, preached about money, was 2.5 years ago. Some churches you go to, they speak about money almost every week. You know, they go on about the lengthy appeals for giving and so on and so on. That isn't our style here. But nonetheless, money and what we do with it is an important discipleship issue for every one of us. Because all of us use money, don't we? Yeah, just do nod. All of us use money. And the Bible says a lot about money. We're going to look at some of that this morning. And it's a discipleship issue. In our strategic objectives, which we've been talking about a lot recently, if you've not seen them, they were published in the magazine earlier in the year. They're on our website under Church Vision. One of our objectives is this: to see everyone who's a part of Greenford Baptist Church giving money to the church as directed by God. So what we're going to do this morning is, first of all, we're going to explore just some of the teaching in the Bible regarding money. There's an awful lot of it, so we're not looking at all of it this morning. We're going to look at some in the Old Testament, some in the New. And then we're going to look specifically at the issue of giving it away. Not just to church, but also other places that we should be giving. So that's what we're going to explore together and share together. Okay, turn to that well-known book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes is an interesting book. I'm not going to unpack the book this morning, but it's a fascinating book that gives a critique of life lived without God. It's written from a perspective of just looking at life. And the phrase is, under the sun. And whenever it says, under the sun, it means looked at from a human perspective, ignoring God. And it's a fascinating book. So maybe subsequent to today, you might just want to sit down, make yourself a cup of tea, and read through Ecclesiastes. Read it through in a modern, contemporary version, and it'll make more sense. If you read it in an old language version, you'll struggle to understand it. It's full of some rather quaint phrases, but you try and read it in a modern contemporary version and just read it through and just allow God to speak to you as you read it. It's a book I recommend to you, Book of Ecclesiastes. We're going to look just at 8 verses from there this morning. Ecclesiastes chapter 5 and beginning at verse 10. Whoever loves money never has money enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with his income. This too is meaningless. As goods increase, so do those who consume them. And what benefit are they to the owner except to feast his eyes on them? The sleep of a laborer is sweet whether he eats little or much. But the abundance of a rich man permits him no sleep. The writer here looks at three problems with money. First is this, three problems with loving money, I should say. The first is this, money doesn't satisfy. Someone described it as like drinking salt water when you're thirsty. It just makes you more thirsty. I've got this great quote from a guy called Derek Kidner writing on Ecclesiastes. He says, if anything is worse than the addiction money brings, it is the emptiness it leaves. If anything is worse than the addiction money brings, it is the emptiness it leaves. Man with eternity in his heart needs better nourishment than this. So the first problem with loving money, it doesn't satisfy. No matter how much you've got, you've never got enough. The second problem with loving money and having lots of it is that it attracts hangers-on. All sorts of stories you see from time to time in the national press about people who come into money, and you discover that it rarely brings them happiness, it often brings them misery. And one of the reasons is the queue of people at the door. Relatives they never knew they had. Friends, in inverted commas, they definitely had never seen before. Or wanting a slice. And the third thing with money, according to Ecclesiastes, having too much disturbs your sleep. You know, I was listening the other day to an interview on the television. I don't remember who it was being interviewed. It was one of the Russian oil oligarchs, you know, that has made this phenomenal sum of money. And he was talking about how in the last 12 months he'd lost, I forget what it was, I mean, it was eye-watering sums of money. I mean, tens of millions of pounds of his money he had lost in the last 12 months with the economic crisis going on in the world. People without much money actually are not very affected by the economic crisis that's going on in our world. The more money you've got, the more you're affected by it. And that's the point that's being made here. The abundance of a rich man permits him no sleep. Either he's worrying about it, he's anxious about how to hold on to it or get more, or maybe he just indulges too much and can't sleep. It goes on, verse 13. I've seen a grievous evil under the sun. Remember that phrase? Under the sun means looked at from a human perspective, ignoring God. I've seen a grievous evil under the sun. Wealth hoarded to the harm of its owner. Or wealth lost through some misfortune. So that when he has a son, there's nothing left for him. You'll be familiar with this proverb, but this is where it comes from. Naked a man comes from his mother's womb. As he comes, so he departs. He takes nothing from his labour that he can carry in his hand. As someone else phrased it, there are no pockets in a shroud. This too is a grievous evil. As a man comes, so he departs. What does he gain since he toils for the wind? All his days he eats in darkness with great frustration, affliction, and anger. Now, someone who amasses loads of money, at the end of life, it does them no good. Wealthy people often have a miserable, gloomy life. Some of the stories you read about some of the world's wealthiest people are so, so sad. Frustrated from cares, anger over failed plans, and then the realization that at the end of life, you can't take anything with you. Of all this material stuff you've spent your life stacking up, worrying about, being anxious about, when it comes to the end of life, you can't take it with you. Let's turn over to the New Testament. 1 Timothy chapter 6. Now, if you're in the teaching that I'm doing here for the first time, just to say to you that at various points as we go through, I'm going to stop and ask questions, and we're going to discuss some of the things together. And one of those questions is coming in just a couple of minutes' time, just to warn you about that. 1 Timothy chapter 6, if you're still looking for it, and you've got one of our purple-covered church Bibles, it's page 1194. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 6. Godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of it. If we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. People who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. Now listen to this next bit very carefully, because this is one of the most misquoted sentences in the New Testament. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Keep your finger in there. We're coming back to it in a moment. Turn back with me to Matthew chapter 6. It's part of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus teaching, Matthew chapter 6. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And down to verse 24. No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. Jesus is very clear in his teaching that people whose hearts are really after God are not focused on accumulating material possessions because they're of no eternal value. Stuff you have in the bank of heaven will be there when you get to heaven. Stuff you have in the bank of earth, you leave behind. It's of no eternal value. Believers, says the Bible, should be content with food and clothing. And that also includes, in the biblical context, housing and shelter. It's not that being wealthy is wrong. It's not a sin to be wealthy. I have one friend. Now, I've got more than one friend, but I have got one friend who is very wealthy. It's not a sin to be wealthy. He's a Christian, church leader. He uses his finance to help in all sorts of different contexts and places, all done anonymously through a blind trust. He gives phenomenal sums of money away. It's not wrong to be rich. But it is wrong to have being wealthy as a life goal. It's wrong because it's rooted in selfishness. It's about accumulating stuff for me. It's wrong also because it can never be satisfied. It's like drinking the salt water. The more you have, the more you want. And no matter how much you have, it's never enough. Now that sentence which we read in Timothy just now that I said was one of the misquoted sentences in the New Testament, It says that the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil.
Okay, so let's think about giving money away. Let's see some of what the Bible says about that. You know, when we become a Christian, we talk about Jesus becoming our Lord, don't we? Yeah? I'll try that question again. When we become a Christian, we talk about Jesus becoming our Lord, don't we? And we, very good. And we have this expression, if Jesus is not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. Got that? Which means that Jesus is Lord of our possessions and Lord of our money, consequently. So let's see what the Bible teaches. And often when we come to this, we come, I think, with the wrong question. We come with the question about how much of the money that I've got should I give away? I think that's the wrong question. I think the question should be, how much of the money that I've got should I keep? Because actually all the money we've got belongs to God. Yeah? So let's look at it turned around. So turn with me, first of all, to Mark chapter 12, verse 41. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins, worth only a fraction of a penny. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, I tell you the truth, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. To see the contrast there, the issue for Jesus was not how much did they give. The rich man gave a huge amount. In fact, it was custom in those days. I may have told, some of you will have heard this before. You know the expression we have in English about people blowing their own trumpet? Do you know the origin of that is from these days? And the origin is this. When a rich man was going to the temple to make a particularly large offering, he would walk through the streets carrying the offering. And in front of him, there would be a person blowing a trumpet, announcing that the rich man was on the way to the temple to make his offering. That's the origin of the expression that we've got back in English about blowing your own trumpet. So we look at this here. This rich man put in a huge amount. But the poor widow came and put two very small copper coins worth only a fraction of a penny. And Jesus said this, and this is hugely profound. The poor widow has put into the treasury more than all the others because they gave out of their wealth. They've got loads left. They've hardly missed what they've given. She put in everything, all she had to live on. So looking at that parable and Jesus' teaching from that, how does that apply to us today? What can we, here in West London in 2009, what can we learn from that parable and Jesus' teaching that applies to us today?
I suppose the way Jesus tells a story, it's sacrificial giving. And I suppose for us in West London, we tend to give out of what we think is surplus. And it doesn't cost us anything. And God is looking for us maybe to give things that actually does cost us.
That's a really interesting comment. I had someone come to see me many years ago. You don't know them. They're not from the church here. Again, someone who earned huge sums of money. They got paid on commission. Now, I don't know what commission rate they got, but I know in a particular week, they sold £2.5 million worth of stuff. Now, I don't know what commission rate, but whatever it is, you're going to get a fair whack out of £2.5 million, whatever the percentage you're on. They had so much money, they didn't know what to do with it all. And we were talking about giving. They came to see me, part of a church that I was at. And they said, you know, I read this parable and I just don't know what to do because I've got so much, I can't actually give a notice that I've given anything. To which my response was, well, maybe you should give some more. Thank you. Other comments coming out of this, how this applies to us today. Some really important things in here that we need to pull out. Joy.
Yeah, I suppose putting it in a question, it would be not how much can I afford to give, but God's, what do you want me to give? Which isn't always an easy one to ask, because then that kind of brings me back to the point that other people have made about God's, relying on God for our needs. But actually, that you know, that will be there no matter what. God will provide for us, so we don't have to worry. If God says, give this amount, and we go, well, how can I afford that? If you do it, God will still look after you, so you're still trusting in God.
And something about not comparing yourself with others. If you're aware a friend's better off and can give more money, and actually that isn't what God's enabled you to or asking of yourself, don't feel bad because you've only been able to give X amount. But actually, if that's what God wants you to give, that's what's important.
That's really important, because sometimes people that don't have very much can feel that actually what they're giving doesn't make any difference. It's insignificant. You know, it's a teeny amount compared to what other people are giving. And the point is, from God's perspective, it's not the amount you put in the plate or the amount that you give, the number of pennies or pounds. That's not what matters at all. That isn't what God is interested in. God doesn't, it's not significant for God that one person gives £1,000 and someone else gives 10p. That's not the issue. The issue is what the person is giving in their response to God. What is it coming out of? And sometimes, you know, when we have very little, we can feel that what we are giving really, it doesn't count. It's insignificant. But in God's eyes, it can be much, much more and much, much greater significance than other people that are giving huge amounts. And we need to see this from God's perspective, not human perspective. You know, sometimes when you get those letters from charities that are asking for money, You give £5 and it does this. You give £10, it does that. But if you give £150, it does this. And if you give £250, it does that. And if you give £1,000, it does this. I mean, I understand why they do that. But that actually is a very human perspective. It's not a godly perspective. Because what's most important to them is the number, the more pounds you give, the better. But actually, that isn't how God looks at things. It's not how Jesus looked at these people here. You know, these rich people, they could have ticked the 1,000, 2,000 box. There wasn't a box on the form that will be small enough for the widow. And yet she gave more than all those wealthy people put together, according to Jesus. Anything else out of this parable before we move on?
I'd say also your heart condition as well, if your heart is right when you're giving that money. And because, as you said, when the man went to give his money, he was blowing his trumpet and making himself loud and clear to let everybody know that he was aware. And the woman just turned around and she just went there quietly, inconspicuous, and just gave her money. And that's what he noticed.
Yeah. Yes, the heart attitude is really important. Last two people.
I think it's crucial to take self out of the giving issue as much as possible. I think a lot of people that I've talked to about it over the years tend to have a mentality of either if I give this, God will bless me, and if I don't give this, God won't bless me, which is a wrong perspective of God to start with. And I think it's really a question of the Christian life is about a life of response. And money shouldn't be any different to that. So therefore, if God puts something on your heart, then you just do it, and you almost don't notice it either way. So you're not really thinking, can I afford to do that or can I afford not to? You're just saying, yeah, that's what God's put on my heart, so that's what I'll do.
And this idea that, that God blesses us more for giving more is actually completely, as you say, completely untrue. I mercifully don't quite remember where it was, but I remember being in a meeting some time ago, and they were taking an offering, and the person in charge of the offering, the pastor may have been, I don't recall exactly, but I do remember this. You know, if you're giving £50, God will give you a £50 blessing. If you're giving £20, God will give you a £20 blessing. If you're giving £10, well, God will give you a £10 blessing. And if you're only giving £5, well, God will give you, you know, just a £5 blessing. So how much blessing you get from God is dependent on how much you give this morning. That is complete and total rubbish. That's not how God thinks. It's not what the Bible teaches at all. It's manipulative and it's wrong. And that's an important point. Yeah.
I look at it from personal views. It's a personal relationship between us and God, and how much we honor him, he is going to honor us. And it's a matter of appreciating him. When I give him, I'm appreciating, I'm respecting him in returns what he is giving me. So it's a way of thanking him with a heart full of joy. Not, oh, I have to pay him. No, I have to pay back him. Something I'm honoring God.
Because we can never give back to God. You know, if we think that we can sort of repay God what he's done for us, then we're in la-la land. Because God's done so much for us, actually, we no matter how much we give, we can never repay even a part. But you're right, it flows out of our gratitude to God. Very good. Well, let's begin to look at some of the other principles here. Will you turn with me back to Genesis? Genesis chapter 14, first book of the Bible. Genesis chapter 14. And we're coming in at verse 18. Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was a priest of God Most High, and he blessed Abraham, saying, "Blessed be Abraham by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand." Then Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. Hold that in your mind, turn over to Hebrews chapter 7, because you're probably thinking, what on earth is that about and what that has that got to do with me? It's picked up in the New Testament, Hebrews chapter 7. Page 1205, if you've got one of our burgundy, mauve, whatever colour it is. Hebrews chapter 7. Then Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. He met Abraham returning from the defeat of the kings and blessed him. And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. Now first his name means king of righteousness, then also king of Salem, which means king of peace, without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life. Like the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch Abraham gave him a tenth of the plunder. Now, this is the important bit. Coming out of that event, which is related in Genesis, the law requires the descendants of Levi who become priests to collect a tenth from the people, that is their brothers, even though their brothers are descended from Abraham. So the principle was this: under the Old Testament law, under the Old Testament covenant, every person in the nation of Israel, the people of Israel, was required to give, on the basis of this event in Genesis, related here again in Hebrews, 10% of their income to the Levites who worked in the temple. And that money was to support the priests and to maintain the temple. And it was a legal requirement. All the people of Israel, 10% of their income was given to support the priests and to maintain the temple. Now, turn back a few pages to Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 7. So here is the New Testament church application of that principle that's there in the Old Testament. 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 7. Who serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard and does not eat of its grapes? Who tends a flock and does not drink of the milk? The obvious answer to those three questions is, well, nobody. Do I say this merely from a human point of view? Doesn't the law say the same thing? But it's written in the law of Moses, do not muzzle an ox while it's treading out the grain. Is it about oxen that God is concerned? Surely he says this for us, doesn't he? Yes, this was written for us. Because when the ploughman ploughs and the thresher threshes, they ought to do so in the hope of sharing in the harvest. If we have sown spiritual seed among you, is it too much if we reap a material harvest from you? If others have this right of support from you, shouldn't we have it all the more? Now, we did not use this right. On the contrary, we put up with anything rather than hinder the gospel of Christ. Don't you know that those who work in the temple get their food from the temple, and those who serve at the altar share in what is offered on the altar? In the same way, the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should receive their living from the gospel. So here Paul is taking that Old Testament principle that 10% of their income was given to support the priests and maintain the temple. And he's applying that same principle, not as a law, but as a principle in the New Testament, saying the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel, that's the equivalent to the Old Testament, should receive their living from the gospel. Now, I believe coming out of that, that every believer, every person who's a committed Christian, should normally give 10% of the income they receive to the local church they attend. It's not a law. It was a law in the Old Testament. In the New Testament, it's a principle. There are obviously some exceptions to this. There are some, for example, wives with non-Christian husbands and others. And there are others that actually should be giving an awful lot more than 10% because God has blessed them with so much. But that's the starting place. Come back with me to Proverbs in the Old Testament. Because it isn't simply about giving to maintain Old Testament priests and temple, New Testament church. There is something else that is a really important principle in both the Old and the New Testament. Proverbs chapter 14. If you're still looking, it's page 648. 648. It's a great book, Proverbs. If you've never read the book of Proverbs, it's not one of those books that you start at the front and read through with a nice cup of tea. It's one of those books you dip into and just read bits from every now and then. Great, great stuff in there. So here are a number of proverbs about poor people. And there are loads in Proverbs. We're just going to read a selection of them. So chapter 14 and verse 20. The poor are shunned even by their neighbours, but the rich have many friends. He who despises his neighbour sins, but blessed is he who's kind to the needy. So in human terms, the poor are shunned by their neighbours, but if you despise your neighbour, you sin. God does not look well on it. Verse 31. He who oppresses the poor shows contempt for their maker, but whoever is kind to the needy honours God. Jump over a few chapters to chapter 22. Verse 9. A generous man will himself be blessed, for he shares his food with the poor. And finally, 28 and verse 27. Is that a message from God? Proverbs 28, 27. He who gives to the poor will lack nothing, but he who closes his eyes to them receives many curses. Okay, let's see how that plays out in the New Testament. Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. It's page 1169, if you're still hunting. Page 1169, Galatians 2, verse 9 and 10. And this is about a dispute that went on in the church. We're just coming in at the end of that. James, Peter and John, those reputed to be pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the Jews. Listen, all they asked that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I was eager to do. In the Old Testament, giving to the poor was required by the law. It's been estimated that people in the Old Testament were required by the law to give around a third of their income, either to the temple or to the poor or to other people in the community. Now, they didn't pay taxes. There was no national insurance and so on. So in some ways, we give to the poor through the taxes that we pay, the national insurance that we pay. But when you add it all up in the Old Testament, it's been estimated to come to around a third of income. But giving to the poor was a principle in the Old Testament, a principle in the New. So how do you think for us now, here in West London, 2009, how does that a principle apply to us, do you think? Those Proverbs, Galatians, how does it apply to us? It's not a difficult question. Dave?
You've got to go by your heart, really. Go by your heart.
Go by your heart, yep. What else? Maybe it's just too obvious.
giving to charity, sponsoring children from abroad who need help and who are poor.
Often we give to people who can give back to us, but we need to be asking God and being sensitive to the needs in our community and asking him to direct us to people who we could be giving to, people who will not be able to give back to us.
Okay. I've had a couple of times where my neighbour's asked me to lend her money and I've actually given it to her, knowing that I didn't have much myself, and God totally provided. He gave me back twice what I gave, both times, which was totally amazing, and it meant I could help her a bit more.
Maybe when we see people on the streets, that we're prepared to not necessarily just give them money, but spend some time, and actually if they ask for food, give them food, buy them food. So actually be prepared not just to sort of give them a pound, but actually go and spend some money on them.
Asking about the principle. Well, the principle hasn't changed, has it? We still, I think, are obliged to give the 10% if we can and follow what you've just spoken about. Just because it happened over 2,000 years ago, is it still applicable today?
Okay. Part of our income tax.
Part of our income tax, okay. All right, final comment. I've got another question to ask you.
I had a similar situation like that when I was 15. I was walking along the street and I had money on me to buy a DVD. I was walking along and there was a tramp on the side of the road. Well, someone who was less fortunate than I. And I said to myself, is this DVD important? Do I really need this, or should I do the right thing and give my money and help this guy out? So I did. And I was looked upon as, you know, in basically not in a good way. And I didn't really care. It was I had to help that person.
Very good, thank you. If you're rich, could you stand up, please? If you're rich, could you stand up? I'm glad to see that you're all standing, because in our world, if you live in the UK, compared to people in the rest of our world, you are some of the richest people in our world. And we need to be reading, you can sit down now, we need to be reading this about the poor in the context of understanding just how wealthy we are. And it's a very important principle. We have responsibility, those of us here in the West, we have responsibility for poor, not just the poor among us, though we have that, but actually the poor elsewhere in our world. Rangina talked about child sponsorship. It's something that we promote in the church here from time to time. Many people in the church here, through Compassion, sponsor a child. Some sponsor more than one. At least one person I know sponsors four. Elsewhere in the world, regularly giving money towards that child, also writing to them, praying for them, receiving letters back from them. So specifically helping people elsewhere in the world. Other people within the church here regularly give money to groups like Tear Fund. We feature Tear Fund often on Sundays. Tear Fund stands for the Evangelical Alliance Relief Fund. And it's one of the largest charities in the UK. And it's helping people through churches elsewhere in our world, helping some of the poorest people in our world. In addition to that, I think we need to be people who are giving generous responses to special appeals for particular needs. Now, it's my observation that sometimes as Christians, people use the fact that they tithe as an excuse to turn a blind eye to the needs around them in this world. Now, I want to ask you a question. I do not want to know the answer to this question, so don't put your hand up. Don't speak it out. Just think about it on the inside. I want you to think how much you have given to the poor in the last 6 months. I don't want to know. I want you to know. How much have you given to the poor in the last 6 months? Just think about that for a moment. For some of you, as you think about that, maybe God is speaking to you and saying, there are things that you need to be doing with your resources as we, as rich people, live in our world. Last year, we made some big decisions as a church with huge financial implications. We doubled the hours that Andy Robertson works for us, so he has an extra day a week to work specifically on youth discipleship. We took this young man, Warren McNeil, on as pastor's assistant. And they were faith steps because we did not have the money coming in at that point in time to meet those expenses. But God and his people have been amazingly faithful. Our income, compared month on month for the first 5 months of this year, compared with the same period last year, this year is £1,300 higher per month. Isn't that amazing? I think we should give God a clap offering because that is absolutely amazing. So it means I'm not coming and talking about money this morning because we're broke or we're in difficulty as a church or we're facing bankruptcy. We've done that in the past on occasions, but it's not like that at all. This is genuinely coming out of a discipleship issue. So coming out of this morning, what are the challenges for us? Our time was almost gone, so let me run through this. I think there are four challenges, and then I want us to read some final bits of scripture to reflect on together. I hope that every one of you, as a result of this, is going to spend some time reviewing the amount of money you give away. It's something I think you should do every year. Every year, Leslie, my wife, and myself sit down, usually in some point during the summer, sometimes a different point of the year, but we sit and we look at our income, we look at what we're giving away to the church, to other places that we give to help poor, our child sponsorship, our support of mission. And we asked the question before God, this was right last year, is it right this year? And then we make changes coming out of that. And if you've not done that for a while, I'd like to encourage you to do it in the near future. I think it is a part of us responding to God. For everything you give to GBC, we would like you to fill in a gift aid form. You can get those from Timmy. Why let the government keep your money when it could be used exclusively for God's work? Doesn't cost you anything. Get a form afterwards from Timmy and fill that in. If you're giving to GBC, you might want to do that by standing order. It doesn't make any difference to us whether you put pounds in the plate, check. But I know for a lot of people these days, they're finding it more convenient to give by standing order. And you can do that. Timmy has a wad of standing order forms. And in particular this morning, I want you to think about your giving to the poor. In our world where we sit among the richest people in our world, I want you to think about your giving to the poor and to reflect on that. If you want information about child sponsorship, you can find Compassion. You can do a Google search for Compassion. You'll find them on their website. If you have difficulty finding it, come and talk to me or Rangina. Rangina, just stand a moment. If you want information about Compassion, Rangina also can help you. She can point you in the right direction for that as well. Here's a quote for you to think about as we finish. It's from Charles Ryrie. I'm going to read at the end of this three passages of scripture, and then I will stop. He said this: how we use our money demonstrates the reality of our love for God. In some ways, it proves our love more conclusively than depth of knowledge, the length of prayers, or prominence of service. I commend that quote to you. More significantly, I commend these three passages from the Bible, which I'm going to read to you. The first one is from Malachi chapter 3. You might want to jot the references down. Malachi chapter 3, verses 7 to 12. If you don't have a pen to do that, you can always catch this on the website later this week. Fast forward to the end, and you'll be able to get the references. Malachi chapter 3, verse 7 to 12. Ever since the time of your forefathers, you've turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. Return to me, and I'll return to you, says the Lord Almighty. But you ask, how are we to return? Will a man rob God? Yet you rob me. You ask, how do we rob you? In tithes and offerings, you are under a curse. The whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, second of these final three readings. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And now, brothers, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. Out of the most severe trial, overflowing joy in their extreme poverty, welled up in rich generosity. For I testify, they gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. Entirely on their own, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the saints. And chapter 9 and verse 6, finally. Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will reap generously. Each man should decide what he has should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all you need, you will abound in every good work. As it's written, he scattered abroad his gifts to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You'll be made rich in every way, so that you will be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. Let's stand, let's pray together as we finish this morning. Father God, we acknowledge that you have blessed us with so much in terms of money and material possessions. We acknowledge before you that we are some of the richest people in our world. We're in the top few percent. And Father God, we thank you because we recognize that all that we have actually comes from you. Father God, thank you. And Father God, I ask that you will help us, every one of us here, as we think about our care for poor people in our world, as we think about our giving in other contexts, that Father God, you will guide us.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.